Today, I thought I'd talk about transformative energy shifts. Basically, a near-death experience is your reboot from version 1.0 to 2.0. But you're without a manual that describes all the upgrades and no phone number to reach customer support. So you're left to hunt and peck the new interface and just figure it out as you go. So if it were this simple, what sites would you search first? You know, many people talk about their emerging perceptions of energy and energy fields, vibrations and frequencies. They really see the world in a different way, and they see life in a different way. So maybe you start there and quickly find user groups talking about these things. Their experience help you bridge from your own new insights so that you can orient yourself in your new operating system. And you begin to understand your new capabilities and improvements over the old you. Among the different ways to integrate this spiritually transformative experience into your daily life, you see how, you know, some are able to continue interaction with their reboot and deepen their experience of it with meditation and spiritual growth. Some express it outwardly through healing and the demonstration of psychic sensitivities and abilities. And others simply live in between the outer and the inner worlds, with a deeper sense of connection to the mystery of life. And as the new sense of who you are descends on you, it's natural to wonder what you're supposed to do now. What do I do with all this? Is everything that was true yesterday true today? Anyway, there are three types of people in this world: those who make things happen, those who watch things happen, and those who wonder what happened. We all have a choice. You can decide which type of person you want to be, but I think for the purposes of our video, we'll just talk about the first group, those who make things happen. The other two can watch and wonder. First, we need to acknowledge that as the veil thins, we begin to feel a greater world around us. Our senses, some new, perceive much more than they previously did, as defined by however we measured that before. When you look at the electromagnetic spectrum from radio waves from one end to the other with the higher intensity cosmic rays, somewhere in between our senses sit. But in the range of the spectrum that we're tuned into, we can hardly sense anything. It's that small. But as our sense of energy changes, it expands beyond the physical universe our senses are limited to. As we extend ourselves, we begin to feel threads of interconnection to both known and unknown people, events, and so on. And currently, we start to find that we see many possibilities on the whole as our destiny. In this orientation that follows a transformative experience, it's natural to ask, what now? If you need to talk to a therapist, I've wondered if the best fit would really be along the lines of PTSD. From what I've heard, hypnotic regression can be helpful. Whatever you do to make sense of it, integration is about using reference points to see patterns within some meaningful context. Once you make the first few passes that help with the high points, you cycle again and again, digging further down, getting as granular as you can. When you do this, you'll be surprised at the logical consistency of everything within your vision and how the tiniest details also have meaning very specific to you. And it just keeps unfolding the deeper you go. When you return to your usual states of mind in which you go about the world, you're thinking about your experience, and different things pop up, and you wonder what they mean in the grander scheme of things. You find answers where you can. Maybe they're in quantum physics. Maybe you find them just in living a life of service. The target is one, and the archers are many. But that which got you here won't get you there. Attention is trained to be short. Back in the 1980s, I was watching MTV like so many kids younger than me, and I noticed how fast the cuts were, and I thought, you know, what's that doing to all these young minds as they're getting accustomed to these really rapid cuts and short scenes? So I timed it. Every cut in most of the videos was only about 1.5 seconds long. So looking at how everyone today has the attention span of a gnat and are diagnosed with ADD or ADHD, you have to wonder. I've talked about how we live in the hamster wheel, chasing the one more thing. and the thing that will make us more competitive or more productive or more likable or more dateable, whatever, maybe a better parent, you know, maybe even more leisure time, which is kind of funny to think that we need to chase one more thing to get back some free time. It smacks of getting ready to get ready. But of all of this running around, you know, it focuses our attention on the world and increases our sense of duality, plenty versus lack, and disconnects us from the feeling of interconnectedness to the great mystery, to each other, and to ourselves. We justify all sorts of reasons why our brains are buzzing without rest, mostly around chasing that one more thing. I'm sure we can remember when seemingly being distracted by having to carry a cell phone on us or answering it at awkward times was a symbol of being important. We've seen how that's worked out for us. But without beating ourselves up over it, we should find ways to try and turn down the volume. Make more time for yourself. When you sit for meditation and your mind is having a hard time settling down, make a deal with it. You'll give it what it wants if it gives you what you want. You know, give me an hour of peace and then we'll go do something stimulating. And it's interesting how you really can strike that deal. And the mind can sometimes be a tough enemy, but it can also be a very loyal friend once you realize how to relate to it. Anyway, it's, you know, transactional, I know, but you're tailoring your message to that audience. As we oscillate between the selves we are, the ones we're meant to be in order to live, and the selves we have to be in order to survive, it creates inconsistencies between how we think and how we act. But as we think, so we become. The art of letting go sees that the world and the culture we live in, outwardly focused, is based on Newton's physics, the science that's based on the past and the scientific method that we use to explore the world. It incorporates predictability and repeatability. And, you know, based on the equal and opposite reaction, it's really all about cause and effect. Again, based on the past, it always worked that way before, so it should work that way tomorrow. But quantum physics, and it seems like spirituality in general, turns all of that upside down. Things become less known and more unpredictable. For many, this is of little interest because quantum physics focuses on the subatomic level, where we don't go to very often. But it's interesting that in one of the ancient Hindu Upanishads, it says, know that the embodied soul is part of 100 part of the point of a hair, divided itself by 100 times, and yet it's still infinite. I guess it's a subtle truth that the soul is described as smaller than the billionth part of the end of a strand of hair. But I think that's because what they're going for here is that the soul is at home in the quantum world. And everything about meditation seeks to take us back to that place, a place beyond the gross duality of this or that, meaning where all things are possible and at all times. I believe that's why quantum physics is so helpful in explaining some spiritual experiences. I don't mean the math, I just mean the concepts. When we use Newtonian physics, it's all based on the past. And we use the past to predict how things will turn out. With quantum physics, we live comfortably and fully within the continual fields of not only what is probable, but possible. When we look for a job because we need money, or a relationship because we're lonely, or health because we're sick, we achieve those things usually with the assistance of another person or a new opportunity. The problem is that we think they, those people or things, are what took us out of that state of lack. And so we form attachments to these outer things for what we need. We don't realize that whatever is breathing life into the universe is simply working through them to help us, because, again, we can't see it. That's the problem with being in a state of lack. We contract in such a way to become duality-minded and externally focused. It's a kind of base-level Maslow hierarchy of needs thing. You know, at the base level, it's all about survival. And as we get, you know, comfortable with that we have some food, we have some shelter, we're warm or cold, whatever, you know, then we can start to think about the world around us and the people around us and start building a society. But anyway, to see the prime mover in all things, we need to go to the quantum level of awareness. We need to go where it's working in order to see it at work. In going to that still point inside ourselves, we move from thinking about ourselves as someone, somewhere, sometime, to no one, nowhere, and in no time. And that is the art of letting go. The practice of letting go bears fruit when we move from there to being everyone, everywhere, in every time. And this can only happen when we let go of the past, which defines who we are and everything we think we know, to embrace the uncertainty of who we will become or who we already are. And that, my friends, is what we call faith. You can see why so few people are up for it. But this is what Jesus meant also by I die daily. And this is what the Zen koan meant when it said, if you're afraid to die, then die now. For having died once, you'll never have to die again. And that's something near-death experiencers can really relate to. As we move from some consciousness to no consciousness, to all consciousness, it's easy to see why some of the after effects reported relate to an intense awareness of connection. In that state of moving from no consciousness or no connection to all consciousness and all connection, we start to see the emergence of things like empathy, telepathy, healing, and so on. Things that represent a greater sense of connection and interconnection. Letting go of the past means you no longer need your memory to tell you what you know. Instead, your intuition fills with all possibilities and tells you what you need to know right there and right then. And then it lets them go. You can see this for yourself when you return from meditation. Write down your experiences and then read them a few days later. You'll be wondering, who wrote this? Sometimes vocabulary and the voice of writing doesn't even seem like yours. I know this is a lot to put out there, especially all at once, but the summary is that whatever meditation you use, whether laying down, sitting, walking, or whatever, for me it's driving, your thoughts should come to rest as you let go of everything you think you are and everything you think you know. And that's letting go. Become no one. And as you enter that timeless space, which is the impossible or eternal now, you become aware of possibilities as expressed as only a place without time can present them. The more still you become, the more probabilities are accessible. One day, you'll come to a place where you stand at the center of all people, all places, and all times, where there is no past or future, only this exact moment. Then you can step up pretty much wherever, whenever, and with whomever you want. And that is the eye of the needle. Remember I said a few videos back that because we project so much of ourselves, so much of ourselves into it, that our understanding of the world and our life here is through the filters we want. And in a transformational experience, we see life through the filters we need. Either way, whether we're just getting out of the shower or going within to that sacred space in non-linear time, we don't see things as they really are. We see things as we really are. It's not something else we're seeing. It's ourselves.